to learn from each other, and I will turn to that in the end. My topic today is the importance of colour in the work of Asplund, and especially during the period between 1918 and 1920. I will also start a little bit earlier. But I confine it to this period because I think that the Stockholm exhibition, although extremely important from the colour point of view, uses another kind of toolbox. So it's actually something somewhat different.
Anders, could you speak a little higher?
Okay.
A little louder.
Yeah. I worked, as I said before, on the library for quite a lot of time, and I've sampled a lot of material on the colour schemes, the historical, original colour schemes. And in doing so, I found out that it was important also to compare with other examples. And over the last 4 or 5 years, I've been giving a seminar course for students at KH, where we discussed and looked into different projects by Asplund, especially working with an archive and art desk. And so I've had the opportunity also to compare with other projects. And now, especially two projects are important in connection to the library, and that is the Lister County Courthouse and the Scandia Theatre. And they are also important to look into because they've been quite thoroughly reconstructed from a colour point of view. So there's material there that could enhance or help our understanding of the colour scheme in the library as well, which is much more complicated, I think. First, it's important to note that the education of Asplund in terms of colour took place at a time when the arts and crafts paradigm was paramount. So his studies at the Royal Institute of Technology sort of informed him that colour should be connected with material qualities. And it was even a problem to use or to add a layer of paint from a moral position. I mean, it was really a problem to use paint in the way it had been used in the 19th century. On the other hand, the premises or the venue for the education at that time was not the monumental complex we know today as KDH, which is a red brick complex very much connected with the arts and crafts movement, especially in colour. It was a 19th century building designed by Philip Bill and Trelander, and it was completed in 1863 already. Masonry rendered, painted rendering. So very much traditional 19th century, exactly the way the teachers of KH in Aspen's time didn't want it to be. So there was a tradition sort of to connect it in a way. So we shouldn't imagine that he had all these sort of brick buildings around him. When Asplund quit KDH and was thought to start his education at the Royal Institute of Art, he rejected that, and he was part of organizing this private education known as Clara School in 1910. And we accepted that here, saw also the publication of Theseus of Stilastikon Parkos and her translation in Swedish by architect Asplund. And this book had been published already in 1902 as a sort of proto-Wolfgang manifesto. And it's one of the very rare texts or international texts on architecture ever translated before the postmodern era. So it had an impact. We don't know exactly how far it went. And we look into what Edith says about colour, and this is from the second edition in 1903, so it's added a new material. We'll say that the first edition was a little bit traditional, there were a lot of 1890s material in it. This was actually new, and on the new interior it says that the new art developed the character of the interior from its own requirements. Above all, colour became preeminent, for we are aware that colour, more than architectural form, acts strongly and directly and creates an apparatus. And I think that this quote is quite well connected with what Asplund actually was interested in doing, especially during the 1920s. And it's about using color as an architectural element itself, not just using color on surfaces which are sort of confined by some sort of ornamental geometry. However, I'm not sure that Asplund really sort of found this important at the time. If we look at what he writes in his diaries from the Italian journey in 1913-14, it's still rather traditional. He's interested in Pompeian ornamental paintings, quite well, more or less like what we see in this room. So perhaps it took some time. And the course of the First World War, the next opportunity for an international journey was in 1918, when Bergström and Gerda Selmer, his wife, traveled on their honeymoon to Denmark. And I think there's a connection here with Gerda Selmer too. Unfortunately, the tablecloth here is missing. Mm-hmm. But that was actually designed in May by her for this room. Mm-hmm. In Denmark, there were several buildings that could interest Asplund in terms of color. Kampmann's addition to the Bibliothek in 1910 was very colorful, but a bit traditional. Carl Pettersson's Forborg Museum in 1915, much more in Asplund's, probably not Asplund's interest, but also very much influenced by this building, which was paramount, of course, in terms of color. The Torvaldsen Museum from 1848, and one of the outstanding monuments of the polygamy debate in the early 19th century. And I should point out here, this photograph is taken this summer, and it's from more or less the same point as one in a snapshot in Asplund's collection, in Art Desk, which is in black and white, of course, and that is that when Asplund visited this building, it was in a weathered decay. And it's often mentioned, you can see that in black and white photographs, that the colorful view that we have of the Torvaldsen Museum today, especially on the exterior, which has been recently been reconstructed, and was not there at the time. Especially these white moldings were not visible like this, but they were more or less gray. But here we had certain decay on the courtyard facade. It's planned to be reconstructed in a few years, and they started actually with a white color and the green color on the white. So it will soon be reconstructed here too. But it was not the super colorful Torvaldsen Museum that Asplund saw. It was a little bit more weathered than we are sort of finding it to get today. This building was, of course, important if Asplund had an interest in the polygamy debate. I mean, this was a natural bridge, of course. It was also a Nordic or Scandinavian building. It was not so high European. It's interesting to compare with and connect to. A year after the war, almost actually contemporary to this journey to Denmark, the Lister County Courthouse project started. And I mentioned that this building has quite recently been reconstructed in terms of color. And Eric Erikson has written an interesting article in 1992 highlighting this reconstruction, which is actually fantastic. So I advised everyone to go there, and I think I'd like to point out that it's great to see. And it's not so easy to see because it's not so up and open. So it takes some time. The interesting thing with this reconstruction is that it has taken a long time to complete. It's not totally complete. The reconstruction of the facade started already in 1994, and it took 20 years to complete the interior, the main courtroom, and the adjacent offices. So it's also true that there are different actors that have made these reconstructions. So it's not one person who's gone through all this material. So this shows that if you look at the facade and the color in the courtroom, they're strikingly similar. And of course, there is a difference, because if you visit this building in practice, daylight makes a sort of difference. It looks dark in the courtroom. That's my sort of sense. But they're strikingly similar. And I think that shows that what has been discussed earlier in terms of Asplund's design in spatial terms, is that the play or interplay between indoors and outdoors could be strengthened by colour. Mm-hmm. So that even the interior is part of the exterior, so the colour helps that. Also, in the adjacent rooms, there is a green, blue, grey colour, a bit stronger actually than we can see in this photograph, and we have a sort of original fragment in the corner there, and it's very close to what I would call complementary. And we will see more of this sort of combinations of complementary colours, or perhaps not as we think clearly. The next year, I started the work on the Scandia Theatre, and now we're back at Drottninggatan. I mean, both the KDH at that time was very close to the library, and not far from there is also the Scandia Cinema, which we will see tomorrow, although not exactly in this chain. Because one interesting thing is here that here we have a new, another facade by Fredrik Dylan Scholander again, and in this case actually Asplund highlights it and he talks about this facade in a very high esteem. And he even uses the weathered, darkened facade as a kind of steam for the portico. So he doesn't seem to be afraid of this painted rendering as a sort of 19th century feature at all. Unfortunately, in the early 1960s, this portico was destroyed, and I mean the reconstructions that have taken place here is mostly connected with the stucco work in the interior. Repeating the facade here again, in stucco, this white stucco is also complemented with a colour scheme used shown in this sketch, which is actually for testing the colour scheme. It's not a presentation sketch for the commissioner. You see that the background colour is green, and the red velvet of the doors, which represents also the red velvet, which is such an important colour in the auditorium itself, works as complementary colours. But here it's very clear now that the red and green is actually complementary. So it seems as though Asplund consciously works and try to explain the differences and the sort of relationships between different parts of the building with complementary color. Mm-hmm. And this is what I've sort of taken with me to the library as well. I would have wished to be able to present a sort of full original color scheme for the facades and for the exterior of the library, but that is very complicated, although it's possible for the building itself. But if we look at the whole sort of environment, the terraces, the walls, etc., that were introduced already in proposals from 1926, it's much more difficult. The first colour proposals are from 1926, but then there are several others changing over time. And since the park was not completed until the mid-1930s, it's difficult to know exactly which of these colour schemes were actually performed or completed in the end. Today, we have a difference in colour between the building and the terraces and the walls. And as far as I know, this is actually a result of looking at these colour sketches or perspectives in the archive. So we don't have full material evidence to be sure of this. But it's kind of tradition because we have seen this for quite a long time. So it's very difficult to say, okay, exactly how was this made? Also, because of the Stockholm exhibition and the development that we discussed earlier, Asplund's views change about this, of course, the whole environment. So he actually introduces new elements which doesn't make it possible to have this coherent image as we have here in this proposal. So it's quite difficult, and I'm still puzzled over the colour of the text. Especially the walls. In some of the photographs in colour that are left, it seems as though the walls were never painted at all, but actually in concrete. But I'm not sure. But I'm just telling you that this is actually a tricky thing, and we don't know for sure. I mentioned earlier the Stockholm Public Exhibition also introduces a new sort of toolbox for how colour can be used. And it's important to say again that, the Stockholm Exhibition is a sort of explosion of colour. So definitely not so that Asplund is not interested in colour. It's just that he uses colour in a different way. I think more like, for instance, Gottfried Semper's invention that antique colouring was primary colour mixed in our senses, within our senses, and not within the paint itself. Because Asplund is not afraid of mixing colours or pigments in the 20s, but afterwards it becomes much more primary colour based, which is probably also a result of international problems. Moving inwards or into the building, I would say that the colour scheme in the mid-axis is quite well preserved. We come into the black vestibule, we have the brown colour of the staircase wall, also the brown and white colour scheme in the rotunda. So it's more about the adjacent parts. It's there that we cannot see the original colour scheme. And in this case, in the north and south reading rooms, it's well known that we also have the original colour scheme preserved. In the center and bookshelves on both sides. So we actually know the colour scheme, although it's in preserved as a whole. But why? Why were these colours chosen? Because in this case, it's not the same colour in both reading rooms. And, the south reading room has this red brick colour, and it does seem to connect well with the paintings by Gunnar Lindqvist. They have a green bottom tone, which seems to be the complementary colour to the red one. So this seems to be the same kind of combination as in the Scandinavian theatre. If we look at the north reading room, we have also the green colour very close, actually, if we take away the dust and the sort of the weather darkened apartments a bit, very close to the bottom tone of the Lindqvist's paintings. So I would suggest that it's actually the same kind of play here, a complementary colour. So the reason why the north reading room is green is actually that it complements the one on the south side. And it could also be part of a daylight aspect. I mean, the sunny, warm tone of the south part is sort of complementary to the red one. And this the colder green brown tone is complementary. But that's a speculation from my point. So in this case, we actually have the colours, we know what they were. They were also, the same colours were in the ceiling as well, so not just the walls, and also the back sides of the shelves, or inside the shelves. Lastly, I would like to show the storytelling room. In this case, it's a little bit work in progress. This is a black and white photograph by Gustav Rosenberg, and the former photograph was also by him. So it's taken in connection with the inauguration in 1998. This case is a black white photograph that is copied on sepia paper. So this is actually a colored photograph of that photograph in the opera. And I actually would propose that this may be the colour of the original colour of this room, if we sort of fill in the vivid colours of Gustav's painting in the house. And the reason for that is not material evidence, it's the critics' reports in the newspapers in connection with the inauguration. Because we have several examples of critics who describe this room as with a grey-brown background, which should be as a sort of background to the painting. So the painting should not be spread out over the room as it is today, but actually be confined to the apse. Magdalene Quist, for instance, tells about the curtains. They were in grey-brown linen. And Gunnar Moskva-Silva's doctor says the same colour we use throughout on the walls, and he actually points out specifically that this is made done to sort of enhance the position of the painting itself. And I would say this is somewhat like the background work of the facade, Schulander's facade, in sense. But to be on the safe side, we would need material evidence. So this is only one hint. Room wasn't all blue. So these are some examples of different samples of source material and how it can be used. And I would like to point out here that, I mean, the sort of reason for bringing this up is not to sort of point at what should be reconstructed or not, but actually to sort of convey and develop knowledge about this. To conclude, I would say that I've shown some sort of examples. First, it was the similar color hues in outdoors and indoors, and second, also the complementary color hues, and thirdly, using color as a background, a dim background to what should be highlighted in the space. I guess that this could inform also sometime the search for a color and color scheme in this room, because perhaps sometimes you can see that this doesn't really fit into the system, so well, something here is wrong. So that could be some sort of way of working. But in the end, I would say that this kind of event, as we're part of here, is so important because it brings together researchers and practitioners. And as I mentioned in this case, we cannot sort of conclude things about color if we don't have both archival and material evidence. Mm-hmm. We don't work by themselves, so we actually have to combine. So collaboration is paramount. Yeah. Thank you very much.